Harper and Harper Audio present Mari and the Curse of El Cocodrilo by Adrianna Cuevas, performed by Aida Reluzco. To Joe, you've always been my good luck. 1. There's no such thing as luck. There's just well-equipped teammates making sure a ravenous zombie doesn't chew on your brain matter for breakfast. The New Year's Eve fireworks whistling and popping outside drown out the lasers and explosions from the game I'm playing on the computer in Papi's office. We have to activate the electric fences if we want to defeat the final zombie horde, my friend Keisha says in my headphones. Her voice crackles and I adjust my earbuds. I ignore her advice and click on my character, enabling a chainsaw attached to a shovel that I earned. My computer screen lights up with a post-apocalyptic girl in dusty combat boots, a bright red scar sneaking down her cheek. She runs at a small group of zombies, their bony arms reaching for her as she slices off the top half of their skulls with a chainsaw. Keisha, Juan Carlos, and I have been trying to beat the final boss in our favorite game, Brain Basher 3, The Munchening, since we all got it for Christmas last week. The first levels were simple. We fought other bands of survivors, worked together to create laser fences, and gathered weapons, ammunition, and vehicles. But the final boss of the game is a lot harder. A massive stampede of zombies who come out of nowhere and rip you to shreds. We keep dying in a pile of bloody limbs. Juan Carlos pops into our Discord chat. Wouldn't it be better to dig a pit and fill it with firebombs? Juan Carlos's character, who has long, flowy braids, swings her barbed wire-wrapped bat at a zombie stumbling toward her and smashes its brains across the screen. She stands on top of the zombie's body, and I hear Juan Carlos laugh through my headphones. His character has the most kills of any of us. Another firework whizzes outside before exploding, the high-pitched whistle and bang celebrating our near victory.
Oye, mi cielo, tengo algo que regalarte.
Abuelita taps on the doorframe behind me before shuffling farther down the hall in her house slippers. We're so close. The meter on the final boss zombie horde is practically to zero. Soon it'll explode in a cloud of brain bits and blood. Almost done, be right there, I call to Abuelita as my leg bounces in Papi's office chair. I have no idea what she has for me, but I don't think it can top beating the final boss.
You gotta go? Juan Carlos asks. We've pretty much won.
I sigh. Yeah, my abuelita wants to give me something before they do their effigy thing. That's the one where you throw those dolls into a fire to burn up bad luck, right? Keisha asks. Her army sergeant character jumps on top of a burning truck and fires her grenade launcher at the stampeding zombies, her long ponytail flying behind her. Yep, every year. Abuelita raided Bobby's old clothes this time around to sew the dolls. At least I won't be embarrassed by all his super loud floral shirts anymore.
Or he'll just use it as an excuse to buy new ones, Juan Carlos says.
Through my headphones, I can hear the fireworks exploding outside his apartment.
Probably.
A clattering sound comes from the kitchen as Mommy sets out our usual New Year's Eve treats of quesitos, pastelitos de guayaba, and empanadas de picadillo to have after midnight. My mouth starts to water as I think about sweet cream cheese and slices of guava paste wrapped in pastry crust and mini pies filled with spiced ground beef. I don't really care about the dolls, I say. As long as Mokosa Mykenzye doesn't see from next door, my abuelitos can dance around the backyard with sparklers sticking out of their ears. The breeze from the ceiling fan slithers down the back of my Houston Aeros hoodie and I shiver. You better hope she never finds out that you call her Booger Mykenzye. Is she still officially the worst person in sixth grade? Keisha asks. She's leveled up. She took a video of Abuelito and Papi in the backyard digging the hole for our lechon on Nochebuena and posted it on Snapchat. She said they were burying a body. That's ridiculous, Juan Carlos says. Lechon is the best. You don't disrespect it. Not on Christmas Eve or Tuesdays or ever. Yeah, tell her that. I click the computer mouse harder than necessary to release a razor net onto three zombies who are about to rip my arms out of their sockets. Lechon is my favorite thing to eat. Abuelito likes to make it the traditional Cuban way, putting a whole butchered pig in a hole dug in our yard that's lined with banana leaves and topped with hot coals. It's a lot of work, but the lechon always turns out delicious, crispy skin on the outside and juicy meat on the inside. Of course,
All Mocosa Mykenzye sees is Abuelito and Papi burying a skinned pig. I love lechon, but sometimes I wonder if it'd be easier to just grill burgers like everyone else.
Oye, no comas los pastelitos antes de medianoche,
Mami shouts, loud enough for the entire neighborhood to hear, and I groan, figuring that Papi got caught trying to sneak some treats before midnight. Maybe if my family wasn't always throwing their Cubanity out into the world for everyone to see, Mykenzye wouldn't scramble like a stumbling zombie to make fun of me at every chance. But it's no use trying to hide from her on New Year's Eve. It's always when we reach peak Cubanity. Abuelita grunted and groaned when she lugged a suitcase around the block because she wants to travel this year. She said that Abuelito always promises to take her to Miami, and hauling her luggage down the sidewalk guarantees that her wish will come true. I hid in my room, praying that none of the neighbors peered out the window and saw her with her huge purple bag dragging behind her. Mommy swept and mopped our whole house, except my room, because she says it's a biohazard. The bucket of dirty water sits by the front door so she can throw it out at midnight, along with all the bad luck from last year that's supposedly mixed in with the water. I can only hope Mykenzye walks by just at that moment and gets doused. At least we won't be eating 12 grapes at midnight as fast as we can. When I almost choked last year, Poppy had to do the Heimlich maneuver on me and everything. I shot a green grape straight out of my throat and into the eye of my sister Lisette. Maybe something that's supposed to bring you good luck shouldn't also try to kill you. Just a thought.
Mari, vamos,
I hear Abuelita call from her room. I groan again. Y'all have to beat the zombie horde on your own, I tell my friends. Abuelita will make me mop the whole house 12 times if I don't go now. Clicking off Brain Basher 3, I head out of Papi's office and down the hall to Abuelita's bedroom. I find her sitting on her bed, her Bible on her lap. Settling next to her, I watch her trace her fingers over the names in the family tree she's written on the first page. Names like Fautina, Ladislao, and Baldomero stare back at me. I've never met any of these people, and Abuelita doesn't talk about them.
Ay, mi cielo, tengo un regalito para el año nuevo,
Abuelita says. Placing the Bible back on her nightstand, she opens a drawer and pulls out a small book. She hands it to me and smiles, the wrinkles on her face deepening. It's a diary. The blank pages stare at me. I have no idea how I'm supposed to fill them.
Para apuntar tus memorias. Cada persona en nuestra familia recibe un diario a los 12 años, y ahora a ti te toca. Hay cosas que no debemos olvidar,
Abuelita says, wrapping her hand over mine as I hold the diary. I'd completely forgotten about the tradition my abuelitos started with Papi, giving a diary to each family member on their 12th birthday. Keisha, Juan Carlos, and I had peeked at Lisette's diary after she turned 12, and it was basically a list of what she decided to wear each day. We were too bored to ever sneak a look again. I don't know how good writing down my memories will be if I can't read my own handwriting, I chuckle. And I'm in middle school. There's plenty of things I'd like to forget. Like Mocosa Mykenzye and her vomit-inducing Snapchats. Abuelita reaches out and takes my hand.
No, mi cielo, nuestra familia, todo lo que pasó con nosotros, hay que recordarlo.
Her voice catches in her throat. I don't know why she's talking about our family history. She may say we should remember it, but she never talks about it. Abuelita shakes her head as if flinging thoughts too troublesome to hold. She pulls something else out of the drawer, and my stomach drops. It's a small, stuffed doll sewn from a shirt Papi wore every day when we were on vacation in Padre Island. Abuelita hands me the doll, and I grip the soft peach floral fabric.
Con esto ya tienes las dos cosas más importantes de la noche en tus manos. Así honramos a nuestra familia, she says.
Abuelita wants me to throw the doll into the fire at midnight, getting rid of all the bad luck from last year. But even though she says this honors our family, how much bad luck will I get if Mykenzye sees me doing this? Do I really have to? I whisper, but Abuelito calls from the kitchen.
Amore, todo listo.
I sigh and tuck the doll under my arm, slipping the diary into the front pocket of my hoodie. Abuelita and I make our way down the hall, through the kitchen, and to our backyard. Everyone's already gathered at the fire pit, standing around the flames like they're gonna hold hands and summon a demon. The cool grass tickles my bare feet. I glance up at Mokosa Mykenzye's house, hoping she doesn't celebrate New Year's Eve, or that she went to bed early, or that she accidentally ate her weight in creamed soup casserole and slipped into a food coma. The air in the backyard is thick, more than the usual humidity imported by Yi, and it smells burnt from all the fireworks people have set off. Light gray clouds of smoke drift through the sky, ghosts looking down on the grass. A breeze moves through the yard, playing with the leaves on Abuelito and Abuelita's mango and avocado trees. Except for one mango tree in the corner. Its branches hang still, not moving from the wind. I squint at the tree and push my glasses up the bridge of my nose.
Todos tienen su muñequita.
Abuelita interrupts my concentration as she passes everyone else a small fabric doll that she's sewn. Lisette waves her doll in the air and nods. I clutch my doll close to my chest, burying it in the white sleeves of my hoodie.
One more minute,
Mommy shouts, making her doll dance in front of the fire. The shadow the effigy casts on the grass is eerily alive. I want to tell Mommy to keep her voice down so she doesn't wake up Mokosa Mykenzye. I glance at the upstairs window next door, but it's still dark. Black shadows stretch from the fire and slither slowly across the yard like snakes. I take a step closer to Lisette. The dark lines weave in and out of the blades of grass as the fire flickers. The flames reach from the pit, growing closer to the doll in my arms, heat pulsing on my skin. But there's no way they're really trying to touch me. That would be ridiculous.
Oye, todo listo,
Abuelito says, grabbing Abuelita's hand. Papi smiles, the fire reflecting a bright orange glow in his glasses.
We're ready, he says.
Abuelito lifts his faded plaid doll into the air, the shadow behind him a giant monster stomping across our lawn. I squint as the dark figure detaches from the effigy, stretching toward me. I scuff my feet in the dirt as my stomach rumbles, but it's not because I'm hungry. It's more from a feeling I can't quite place, something churning in my gut like a storm in the Gulf. Because no matter how many times I blink, no matter how thoroughly I wipe my glasses on my hoodie, the shadows are still there, reaching out. Abuelito clears his throat and counts down.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Vete pa la porra, mala suerte.
He tosses his doll into the flames, and we stare as the fire licks at the fabric, the individual flowers brightening and then turning black as they burn. He squeezes Abuelita's hand as she cries,
Adios, mala suerte,
and flings her effigy into the fire. It crackles in the flames as smoke rises above the roof of our house and swirls toward Mackenzie's window. Abuelita leans her head on Abuelito's shoulder. She takes a deep breath as small tears form in the corner of her eyes, sparkling in the firelight. New Year's Eve is supposed to be exciting, with loud fireworks and tasty food, but some years, Abuelita looks sad as she watches the fire. I sniff and pick out a loose thread on my effigy. The air smells like rotten fruit, which is odd because Abuelita's obsessive about picking up any mangoes or avocados that fall in the yard. And this smell is different. Like when Mommy keeps strawberries in the fridge too long and they start to get fuzzy. The fire calms after devouring the effigies, the shadows resting in the grass. I take a deep breath, but cough on the acidic smell in the air. Three large fireworks whiz through the air and explode above us in a rainbow of colors. The yard lights up in a white glow. I jump and almost drop the effigy. Papi and Mommy both shout, "See ya, bad luck!" and along with Lisette, toss their dolls into the fire. I wince at the shouts. We're so loud. Glancing at Mackenzie's window, I notice the striped blue curtains moving and I clench my fist around the arm of the effigy. My stomach flip-flops as the breeze swirling through the yard inches up my back and curls through my hair. I spot Mackenzie silhouetted in the pale light coming from her bedroom. My throat tightens. Her face is just another shadow, but I can picture the smirk plastered across her thin mouth.
Niña, hay que quemar la muñeca,
Abuelita says, gesturing for me to throw my doll into the fire. Loquita,
Lisette says, her shadow stretching tight across the yard like a creeping ghoul. We can't eat until you toss your doll in. Let's go. A flame erupts from the fire and licks the grass as the smoke descends on my shoulders, making me cough.
Poppy joins in. Come on, kiddo. You know it's tradition. Don't be rude.
My eyes stay glued on the window. I see Mackenzie's phone in her hand.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.